Hi, hello guys. I'm Sam Haig. I'm a project lead on the OVSDB project on Opendaylight. We're going to talk about OpenStack, Opendaylight integration. Let me introduce these guys first. Saku Yamahato, he's a project lead also on networking-odl and the Neutron northbound. Arvind Somya, he's working on the networking-odl, the V2 driver. Vishal Thapar, he's working on VPN service project on Opendaylight. And Anil Vishnoi, he works on everything. So we'll leave it at that. He's a key guy, though. Actually, we'd like to say thank you for showing up. We know it's kind of, we're about hump day right now. It was a good party last night. It's late in the afternoon, so we appreciate you guys coming out. Okay. Maybe not. Just go that way. So we kind of just want to show first off the project contributors. For the network virtualization and the OpenStack integration that we've got, there's a lot of moving parts. And so we thought it would be a lot easier just to kind of show the names. You can see the different areas that each of the individuals works at. During this presentation, we're not going to go too deeply into the technical details. So this is kind of another way, if there is something you kind of have a question about, we've got the people there listed so you can find their names and track them down. Okay. Go to the next one. Yeah, okay, so what is Opendaylight? Opendaylight is a SDN platform, a software-defined networking controller. At its simplest, the same way that OpenStack is it's an orchestration for compute resources. Opendaylight, the SDN controller, it's an orchestrator for virtualized network resources. A key thing about Opendaylight is it's modular. From the beginning, that's been a kind of a distinguishing factor about Opendaylight is it's very easy to have all the network functions, the services and things like that are all it's microservices architecture, so they're all wrapped as small service blocks. So it's very easy to take those blocks and build up higher level applications. It's very easy to, the platform, it's open, it's diverse, it's very inclusive. Because of that modular architecture, you can include different features, so you can build up, again, whatever type of deployment you want. And because of that modular architecture, it's very, multi-protocol. There's a bunch of southbound protocols, so you can control many different devices. And because of that modular architecture and being so open, we can support a broad range of use cases. Government use cases, cloud, NFV use cases. The last point, the OpenStack, we're talking about the OpenStack integration. That's always been a key priority for Opendaylight, is to always be able to work with OpenStack. So we kind of wanted to highlight that. Okay. So here's what, this is kind of an architecture picture of Opendaylight. As you can see there, it's a classical picture, top to bottom. If you've ever seen anything about SDN, you've got APIs on the northbound to access services in the middle and the core, and then southbound protocols to drive those devices. That green block, that's the core of Opendaylight. There's a bunch of different types of services and functions, like L2 switch, host tracker, the netvert, VPN service for, for network virtualization pieces. That's the core of Opendaylight. And you can see they're all little blocks, and they are really all little blocks, as we talked about that microservice architecture. On the northbound side, all those services, they expose APIs. You can see there's, we have REST conf interfaces for high-level applications can now drive through and get access to all those services and functions. Down at the bottom, the blue blocks are the gray-bluish, that's all the network protocols to control the devices, the network elements. You can see there's like OVSDB, NetConf, Lisp, BGP. They're all pluggable. Another block in there is that blue block, that long block, the SAL. We call it the MD-SAL, the Model-Driven Service Abstraction Layer. That's an important piece to the whole architecture. It uses a language called Yang, which is a modeling language. Basically, that's where you can map all your network functions to these devices and expose higher-level application interfaces. That's how you can do all the little building blocks. They all work through this MD-SAL, and you can and it provides a consistent interface from top to bottom. Some other magic that comes out of that Yang and the MD-SAL is that it's what exposes. It actually, when it's compiled, it exposes those RESTconf interfaces. It exposes the Java code, which also the actual code itself uses when all the blocks are interfacing with each other. So again, it's just kind of it's a consistent interface from top to bottom. Okay. So this is kind of a deployment architecture, and it's very similar to anything else you would see with OpenStack. You've got a control node, an OpenStack control node. Key pieces there is the Neutron networking ODL. That's the ML2 driver, which is able to pass Neutron API into to OpenDaylight controller. And then we come across to the OpenDaylight controller, which is where OpenDaylight's running. Key pieces there are the Neutron northbound, which is receiving all the Neutron APIs, and OVSDB, which is driving the OVS, the switches, and then compute nodes, any number of compute nodes. Typical things, you've got a bridge there, OVS is running there, you've got virtual machines which are being instantiating, and OpenDaylight is setting up all the networking for all those switches and all the VMs that are there. We show that as a network control node for the OpenStack. It's probably not in the typical sense before DVR was around. It's not a dedicated network node in that sense. We also support also the virtual routing in L3, so that's also distributed across the compute nodes. That network node control node is really, if there's extra agents like the DHCP agent in this case, or that networking ODL. So that's kind of an overview of OpenDaylight. Now we're going to go ahead and talk about moving on, to Beryllium, the features that we've implemented this release. And Saki's going to take over.
Okay, thank you, Sam. The community has been working on features so hard. So we'd like to introduce new features. What was delivered in the previous development cycle, and what we are planning to work on for the next development cycle. I mean OpenStack Newton cycle and OpenDaylight Boron cycle. So this slide summarizes the features we have delivered in the previous development cycle. I mean OpenStack Mitaka cycle and OpenDaylight Beryllium cycle. The main focus was high availability and stability. Actually, people is starting to use it and also starting to test it. For example, OPNFV project is continuously testing OpenStack integration with OpenDaylight, and we have feedback from them. So as OpenStack integration is the biggest use case of OpenDaylight, so we are seriously taking care of it. So this is OpenDaylight committee response to it. So we have much improved its stability, and we have fixed many bugs. Next slide, please. And then this slide summarizes our future plan for OpenStack Newton cycle and Boron cycle. In the last cycle, we have much improved its stability. So we have widened our scope to include scalability and also to fill major feature gaps. So some features didn't finish yet, so we have some leftover from the last cycle. So we'd like to finish those unfinished features like V2 drivers, and also we'd like to finish some HA functionality. And in addition to that, we'd like to add more new fancy features. In the following slides, we'd like to explain those major items in detail. First one is port binding. Though the main goal is to support not only plain open vSwitch, but also DPDK enabled open vSwitch. And also, we'd like to support another software with switches, like FDIO, FIDO, VPP. So in Mitaka Cycle, we support OVS DPDK, which is DPDK enabled OVS, which is much faster than plain open vSwitch. So now, OpenDaylight mechanism driver understands not only plain open vSwitch, but also DPDK support of open vSwitch. So it found out the open vSwitch in the computer node supports DPDK. It switched to use DPDK so that you can enjoy accelerated performance. In Newton Cycle, we are planning to support FIDO, FD.io VPP switch. So this will be this logic will be more enhanced to support any kind of switches in the future. Next features lightweight test framework. This is the answer. This is OpenDaylight community answer that the community is very value its testing, and it is quite important to test any kind of logic. So for now, in order to test OpenDaylight integration with OpenStack, we have to deploy full OpenStack and OpenDaylight. It is very quite time-consuming, and sometimes it is difficult for OpenStack developers. So we introduced a new test harness to simulate OpenDaylight behavior so that we can test OpenStack Neutron without OpenDaylight. So this helps developers so that development cycle is shortened. And also this test harness can be used for HAKS. For example, network can fail between OpenStack Neutron servers and OpenDaylight, and such transient network failure can happen. In that case, Neutron OpenDaylight mechanism driver should retry, and when network come back, they should continue to work. So this test harness can simulate such transient network failure. In order to test this kind of network failure, we have to set up network, and then we have to, for example, we have to unplug the physical Ether cable. But with this test harness, we can simulate such failure so that we can exercise such HA logic. And it is quite important to exercise those logics. And in Newton Cycle, we are also planning to introduce a test harness to simulate Neutron itself so that we can test OpenDaylight without OpenStack, so that we can exercise, we can easily test OpenDaylight logics. And also we can simulate multiple computer nodes with a single physical hardware, so that developers can test multiple node deployment case with your laptop machine or desktop machine. And also developers or users can get a rough idea with single machine. Okay, I'll pass the mic to the Arvind.
Thanks, Sasaku. I was going to give an overview of the ODL V2 driver, which is a new driver we introduced in this cycle. So anybody who's used the V1 OpenDaylight Neutron driver knows that it works, but not very well. It doesn't scale at all. Once you go beyond a certain number of networks, you will be just stuck because it tries to do this giant DB syncs across. So our goal with this driver was to make a atomic microtransaction. So every API call in Neutron will be synced individually to OpenDaylight, and we have implicit retries. And also, going down the list, we did it for Neutron HA and scalability. So if they have multiple Neutron servers running, multiple ODL endpoints running, you will have multiple sync agents or sync threads, which will actually work in an HA fashion. For the first phase, we only did the mechanism driver and the L3 plugin. We just wanted to get like a proof of concept out and just to demonstrate how it works and what the performance improvements were. Based on that, we're still fixing a few small minor issues with syncs and all that stuff. But once that is ironed out, we do plan to convert other service plugins, maybe like LBAS or VPNs, into the same architecture. So how this plugin works is it asynchronously synchronizes resources. I know it sounds like an oxymoron, but it synchronizes resources from Neutron to OpenDaylight, but it does it in an asynchronous fashion so that you're not blocking the Neutron API on every call. Whenever whatever API call you get to Neutron is stored in a journal database, and there are like separate worker threads which work in the background to actually synchronize this. And what you get with this is like you're immediately, your Neutron API is not blocked. So if you have like a large operation going through, or if ODL itself is dead and you just wait to hit the HTTP timeout, your Neutron API will be stuck just waiting for that call to return. Once we translate that into async, Neutron is not blocked. And as it says, it's atomic transactions per API event. So each API event, like a create network, a create port, a create subnet, is treated as an individual atomic transaction, and it will try to sync these, and it also has some automatically configurable retries. So in case it fails, it'll try up to an X number of times, and then even if that fails, then it marks it failed. We had to add a lot of validation to this because some events in Neutron come in very close to each other. Like if you use Horizon, then a port create might actually show up in the database before a subnet create because they're like less than a second apart, and we did not have that kind of time granularity. So we added a lot of validation to this model with extensive validation models like do not send a port create before a network and a subnet create, do not send a subnet create before a network create, or, and the same applies for delete logics as well. All the hierarchical child nodes have to be deleted before you can delete a resource. So you get retries for failed journal rows, and it has a backoff mechanism in case OpenDaylight itself is down. There's no point in just hammering the CPU waiting to sync it. So we do have some sort of a backoff, and it keeps retrying to contact ODL at regular phase. It is still in the beta phase. Like I mentioned, we introduced this driver like a couple of months ago, and there's been quite a good acceptance in the community, and people from other companies have also come in, and they've started fixing issues. This one. Thanks. So it's like a very high level overview of how this works. In each of these blocks, you can see like we have multiple Neutron servers. Each one of them is running a sync thread. And they're all talking to a common journal database, which is populated by all the API events coming in. So with the validation model and with the validation model in place, this kind of, we kind of ensure that one thread doesn't try to step on the other person's or what the other thread is doing. All of these are controlled by a state machine in the journal database. So all of these journal rows will have a state of either pending, processing, failed, or completed, which are pretty self-explanatory. And this is a very high level, I put up a web service diagram as a very high-level overview of what the call logic is here. There's a lot more things going on here, but this is presents like a general overview of how this whole logic works. And we'll be posting these slides. No. Will we be posting these slides?
Yeah, I think we'll be posting it.
Okay, we'll post these slides in case you need more time to look over the diagrams and everything. And with that, I will hand it over to Vishal.
So I'm going to talk about the BGP VPN support and the L2 gateway support that is available in Mitaka and Beryllium. Just to give a brief history of what BGP VPN is for those who are not familiar, there's already OpenStack project networking BGP VPN, which is a plugin. What it does is, like lots of existing providers, they have tenant networks which are beyond the gateway running L3 VPN, which is the MPLS BGP VPN. So what this project aims to do is bring that VPN connectivity all the way inside the data center up to the VMs. So that networking BGPN is a plugin on OpenStack. We had the similar functionality available in OpenDaylight even at the previous Lithium release. What we have done in Mitaka and Beryllium is integrate them together so that the OpenDaylight component, which is a VPN service project, is now orchestrated by OpenStack now. So he just mentioned about the V1, V2 driver. So when we started writing driver for this, V2 framework was not ready to use. So the driver code we decided to still host in the networking BGPVPN repo. It is the V1 driver and it works. You can test it. VPN service project in Opendaylight is providing the backend, and we also have a fuel plugin for it. Going forward, once the V2 framework, as he's mentioned, it's still being tested, once it's fully robust and ready, then we'll be moving that driver also to V2, and you will have all the semantics like sync and retries for failures. Like I mentioned, fuel plugin is already available. I don't know how many of you attended the Gluon and the OPNFE sessions today in the morning. So they mentioned VPN service, MPLS, BGPVPN. So this is what they are using already. Networking L2 gateway, so we were hoping to get it fully functional between in the Mitaka and Beryllium release. We ran into some issues. L2 gateway is the project which brings, you know, connectivity between bare metals and the VMs running on the computes. It's also, it has been there since the Kilo release of OpenStack. So what we did here was, again, implementing backend functionality in Opendaylight and the ODL driver for L2 gateway. We ran into some issues because the way L2 gateway plugin was written, it did not support adding a new service driver for it. So we had to take help from the L2 gateway project to get it done. And by the time it was done, it was too late for us to have the driver in Mitaka. We still might get it in Mitaka, so hopefully. So the code is up for review, and ODL backend could not be ready, and it would be available only in Boron release. Anil.
Hi, everyone. I think next time I need to bring my sunglasses to present here. And this was a bad joke to, you know, wake up people who are sleeping somewhere in the corners. So, yeah, so I'm going to talk about a little bit about a network project, which is basically an OpenStack backend networking provider in ODL. And then I'll be briefly talking about the SFC support in network. So if you look at this long list here, this is the work which we did in a Beryllium release, okay? And just to give a brief about the network project was a part of the OVSDB project in OpenAlight, and recently we split at it because OVSDB project has a OVSDB southbound plugin that talk to OVSDB devices and the network virtualization piece of it. So we just took it out, and it has, you know, its new project life. But this is something, you know, is Beryllium, so we kind of have the whole list there. So some of this work is in an OVSDB southbound plugin, some of this is a network project. So MDSL migration is the diagram that Sam shown, right, related to fourth release of Beryllium, that big boxes. So ODL uses MDSL, and the old network code was basically using the POJO-based service abstraction layer. So we migrated to the Yang-based MDSL layer. It's a model-driven service abstraction layer. So that was one of the major work which we did. We enable the support for the clustering because that's, you know, it's a no-go if you don't have that support. So it's the first implementation we have as of now, and we are trying to harden it up. So some of the work is still going on there. We have a support for hardware VTAP, and hardware VTAP support is more is basically, you know, same OVSDB hardware VTAP schema support. We added this for, you know, this is basically used by L2 gateway service. So folks who wanted to implement L2 gateway service in OpenDaylight, they wanted this support, so we added that one. We have a support for OVSDB decay. This is the work that is done by Intel folks. And we have, you know, support in network also, so you can deploy your OpenStack deployment using OpenDaylight with a DB decay support. We added support for QoS. We added support for security group, and we support both, you know, contract support and, you know, a simple flow-based support. Flow-based support is limited because of the obvious reason, because the OVS don't support a lot of things. If you deploy OVS that has a contract support, then you can enable security group with a contract. We have a router manager that actually does, you know, IPv6 related stuff, ND and SD and all those stuff. Then we have we implemented the SFC. It's not really implemented, but there is a version that's present in network that actually give you some SFC support from OpenDaylight. So this was a POC work that we did in Beryllium. So if anybody wants to try it out, they can do it. But we are trying to formalize this work so that you know it can have a formal integration with all the orchestration pieces. And this is I'm going to go detail into this one. So the next slide actually shows you what you are trying to do. So in the whole summit, you must have been attending NFV tracks and other telco tracks, and they all basically looking for NFV support, and SFC is something which pops up every time, right? So this is one of the key use cases that people actually want to realize. So OpenDaylight, because Network is one of the pure OpenStack provider, which actually go by the APIs of the OpenStack. So for us, it's kind of an obvious next step to support the SFC APIs. Given that OpenStack now has a first version of SFC APIs, so networking SFC is the work which they are doing, and they are kind of finalized the first set of APIs. So I think it's the right time for us to kind of implement, provide SFC support through the OpenDaylight controller. And the other thing is, now given that, it creates more value given that we have a consumer in OpenStack that actually want to consume networking SFC API. So if you know, if you attended a Tacker session, so Tacker is basically a Mano and a VNF manager. That basically, working on the people in that project is working on providing support for VNF forwarding graphs, and they are planning to consume networking SFC API. So, we already have a user who wants to consume networking SFC API. So from our side, we just wanted to implement this in OpenDaylight so that, we can have an end-to-end deployment using Tacker, networking SFC, and the ODL. So Tacker is not just one use case we want to start with, but there are a lot of other consumers, whoever consume networking SFC, they can get a support from OpenDaylight. So we and the good thing is in OpenDaylight we already have a very mature SFC implementation, that is OpenDaylight SFC project, and a lot of consumer we have two consumer as of now is a GBP project to one and a network project. They basically consume it, and there is external consumer also, that is OPNFV. So OPNFV also consume the SFC piece from OpenDaylight. So given that we have a mature implementation of it, to provide the whole end-to-end integration, there are three major pieces of work that we need to do. So first one is, we need to write a driver, is a pass-through driver, that actually pass networking SFC API directly to ODL. Okay, that driver is one of the major piece in that. We already have a blueprint for that, and people discuss this merge. The work need to be done, and people are working on that. Second, these two bullets, basically, rest of those two work need to be done in OpenDaylight side. So we need to define a Yang model for the SFC flow classifier and for SFC, because ODL is all based on Yang. So that is the another major work that we need to do. And the third one is a translation layer. So why we define these Yang model is we want to keep these model as generic as possible so that it's not stuck with just one provider in OpenDaylight. So if you want to write your own SFC provider for OpenStack APIs, you can plug in your own bundle into it that provide SFC, and you can start using it rather than the current version we have in OpenDaylight. So that's why we want to make it generic. So once we have, we need to provide that pluggability, then you need to provide a translation layer, because these different SFC implementation will have their own models. And once you have your own model, you need some translation from the generic model to those specific model. So that's one of the translation layer you have to write. So these are the three major pieces which, me and Tim Rosett from Red Hat, we are going to work on it. And there are people from other organization also interested, and they'll be joining us. So any of, are interested in this work, please, feel free to contact any of the person in OVSDB, OpenDaylight, and networking-odl project, and we'll hook you up. So this all is currently work in progress. So anybody wants to give any feedback, not really in contribution in term of code, but any feedback about how we should go about it, how the design should be, and any other use cases that we should accommodate, please, feel free to reach out to us. This is the high level integration architecture, how this thing is going to work. So as I mentioned, so network SFC has APIs. So whoever want to consume networking SFC, they are going to call the networking SFC API. Those APIs call will be propagating to networking ODL, and networking ODL will be passing it through the SFC driver, which we are planning to write, to the ODL. And if you see all these green boxes, these are the boxes which I was talking in the previous slide, and these are the work in progress. So SFC driver will pass data to the Neutron northbound, and Neutron northbound is going to write these data into a data store, the MD cell layer, so where we store all the data, and that is basically user configuration. So whatever API is for a flow classification and for SFC chain we'll get, we will store in their appropriate models. And then there will be a provider for that. So if you see the upper two boxes network GBP, these are one of the consumer. These are the basically flow classifier provider. So they will listen to these flow classifier models, and then they will do the backend flow installation and realizing the classifier on the SFF and all those things. And then we have SFC implementation. So we'll write a translation layer that will take the generic SFC model, convert it to its SFC specific model, and then SFC will do the job of creating a chain. So this is the high-level architecture which we are planning to do. So most of these pieces need to be done, and hopefully in the next release we'll have something working demo for you guys. So yeah, and this is one of the use cases which we're trying to realize. So when we want to show the end-to-end game, that how this works. So Tacker is one of the use cases which we are targeting. We already have a working POC implementation. That work is done by Tim. So, but in that case, it's not really formal. What happens is Tacker directly go to ODL. It doesn't go to the networking SFC, and then it goes to Neutron northbound. That direct communication is from Tacker to SFC. Okay, so that is not a formal integration in terms of when you want to do this through OpenStack. So yeah, this is one of the use cases which we are trying to realize, and we'll hopefully do work on other use cases once we are kind of done with this thing. So yeah, this is pretty much we have. So just to summarize it, because the kind of services we support, kind of goals we have. ODL is one of the viable, and I would say, if you go to the SDN controller, is one of the main controller that you guys can target to, deploy. Okay, we are definitely trying toward making it more hardened, so that you don't say, people generally complain that it's not deployable, and that's our main focus, which we're where we are heading towards. So HA and scalability and this feature parity is the thing which we are working on currently. So anybody who wants to deploy it, it's a time to kind of reach out to us so that we can get more feedback and can do the work which actually make it a deployable controller. It's an active and diverse community. If you see the initial contribution, there are around 6 to 7 organizations that contribute to this project, and this is pretty diverse. We are not in a push mode. We are always kind of open arm. We invite people to come and contribute it and have a healthy technical discussion about things. So that's a good thing, and that's a good thing about the whole ODL community, and specifically the network project and the kind of community we have there. We are working on more feature and functionality. So if you are looking for any new feature in OpenDaylight side or networking ODL side, please reach out to us. That's pretty much it. How much time we have? So I think we have 7 minutes for questions. So yeah, guys, you can come up. I'm not going to handle all the questions. If you can come to the mic, that would be good.
So you mentioned about the deployment. Are you targeting that for your SR, or is it for Boron?
So that's for some of the feature is going to be in Boron. So stability part of it, whether it's a HA or a clustering, that is available in Beryllium and a Boron both. So that is the piece which we are going to harden up. But the new pieces that is related to SFC and all those things, that is going to go in Boron release. Okay. But the stability, bug fixes, clustering, anything that we need to harden it up for deployment, that definitely will go to Beryllium as well.
Dilution from Comcast. Can you share what's the, you mentioned about the FIDO in the project, what's be the support either on the OpenStack side or also on the OpenDaylight side?
FDIO support is being done under OPNF project, which is called Faso Data Stack project. And work needs to be done in Neutron and OpenDaylight and also FIDO. We have to touch all of that components.
So in one of the slides you mentioned there is a hardware VTEP support mm-hmm. coming in. Is that L2 or also L3?
So in Beryllium it's currently just L2, and in Boron we'll be adding L3 also, so that's the plan.
Okay.
So L2 is already there, L3 would be coming in next release.
Any other question? Then I think we're good. And thank you guys, thanks for joining us.
If you still have any questions, do come to our booth tomorrow.
So we have an ODL booth down there. So anybody who has any question related to ODL and what is coming, what is there, please feel free to come to that booth. We'll happy to answer your questions. Thank you.